taste like strawberries on a summer evening, and it sounds just like a song. I want your belly and that summer feeling. I don't know if I could ever go without watermelon sugar.
We're going to have a great panel today.
Yeah, so our panel tonight is behind the scenes, building a campaign. And the idea is that we've got a group of panelists from various different backgrounds and that are going to kind of give you input on how they approach and collaborate with other team members. So your MC of the panel, your amazing moderator, is going to be Marissa. And from talking to her over the past couple of days, I'm really excited about her being able to really pull out from these panelists some of the really great information that you're going to be able to use tomorrow. So quick background about her. She is Senior Director of Marketing at Casper Group, which is a disinfection technology company, and she's based out of Dallas. So again, awesome silver lining about virtual is that we can get awesome people from anywhere. We don't have to just be in Houston. So really excited to have her from Dallas tonight. She's mentioned earlier, but in case anyone missed it, her alma maters are Texas State University, and she got her MBA from Baylor. As she mentioned, somebody might have missed it if you were hopping on closer to five, she actually competed in this event when she was at TSU. So she's been in your shoes. She also participated at NSAC while she was in school. So this is really near and dear to her heart. So we're really excited for her to be here. Also, when I was looking over all of the amazing things about her, she is super engaged in AAF and AD2 on both on a local, regional, and national level. She's been board members, she's been chairwoman, she's been all kinds of stuff, and we're really, really appreciative for everything she does. And right now, she's currently serving on the AAF District 10 Advertising Education Sponsorship Board. So this is definitely something that that Marissa is passionate about and being able to share expertise with all of you. So last but not least, I will let her introduce the panelists and kind of give you guys a feel for what this conversation is gonna be for the next hour or so.
Thank you, Kate. And thank you everyone. A big thanks to AAF Houston for hosting today's event. And Valentina, Kate, and Rose for putting this together. You women are wonderful. And our amazing panelists for joining us today. We have Aaron Bryant, Gabriel Flores, and Erica Long. And I'll give a brief overview of each of them, but also want to shout out the schools. We have a lot of great schools here today. And if you want to engage with us online, feel free to use the hashtag AAF Student Conference. And if you have any questions for the panelists, go ahead and type them in that Q&A and we'll try to work them into this dialogue. We'll be reviewing that as time allows. And we want this to be a working session to make you feel successful. And I know people say win or lose, it's about the experience, but hey, I don't think my team won when I did this and I'm doing okay. So keep that in mind, have fun with it. I know it's stressful, but you guys are amazing. And after this event, feel free to connect with me and the panelists on LinkedIn or any social media of your choice. We want to help you as you navigate your career. So up first, we have Aaron Bryant. So Aaron is the Senior Director of Marketing previously for the Harlem Globetrotters. Aaron is a strategic marketing, branding, public relations, and sponsorship professional with 19 plus years of team and individual experience in developing and implementing dynamic, results-driven campaigns to support established and emerging consumer brands across a diverse set of industries and international markets. She's literally a Jill of all trades. Some of her previous experience has been with the Harlem Globetrotters, Live Nation, and Feld, representing live events such as Disney on Ice, the Ringling Brothers, Monster Jam, and more. As she mentioned earlier, she recently completed her MBA at Tulane University to bring further financial insights to her marketing expertise. Up next, we have Gabriel Flores. Gabriel is creative director at Tippett & Moo. Since joining Tippett & Moo in 2012, Gabriel, or Gabe, has been behind most of the award-winning work that has been developed for Sonic Drive-In, Gabanellini, the Houston Dynamo, and Michaels. He began forging his creative chops in agencies such as Taran, TBWA, and Leo Burnett. His experience covers a wide spectrum of brands and categories such as American Express, General Motors, Procter & Gamble, Corona, Kellogg's, Chevron, AT&T, and Aeromexico, just to name a few. A sunny Mexico City native, he's known for being a loving family man and severely judging people by their taste in music. So, Valentina, I think you passed the test. We got some compliments on the opening music. And man, these are some big brands. So you guys are going to have a lot to learn from both of these guys. And last but not least, we have Erica Long, a fellow Dallas native who I'm happy to share today's panel with. Erica Long is a senior account manager at Belo & Company on the enterprise team. She works with large enterprise clients such as Carter's, PenFed Credit Union, Heartland Dental, and she is the main point of contact and strategist for omnichannel clients. Previous to working at Belo & Company, Erica has worked for companies that have a technology-first focus, such as Simplify and Savory. Here, she got to work with different clients across several different verticals, such as Texas Instruments, GameStop, Kaiser Permanente, Salvation Army, Paycom, and Varidesk, Ford, and Chevrolet as well. This is where she gained her exposure to large enterprise clients and how to create effective processes to meet and enhance the growth of her clients. In addition to helping strategize new ways to engage customers for her clients, she has served as the 2018-2019 president of Ad2 Dallas, a young professionals advertising organization that aims to meet the needs of Dallas young advertising, marketing, and communication professionals and students alike. Erica has over 8 years of event planning and organizational experience and often uses her storytelling skills when presenting to an audience. I think Erica and I can both speak to how wonderful the American Advertising Federation and Ad2 has been for our career. So please connect with us if you have any questions about how to get involved. All right, so each team member, which we have a variety of different roles here, plays a critical role in bringing their talents and expertise to the table to make a truly remarkable campaign. It's never just one. So through brainstorming, collaboration, and different skill sets working together, a marketing challenge can be solved with a winning creative message, a strategic media plan to have it seen, and an outside-the-box idea for earned PR as well, PR or public relations, as I'm sure you all know. In the next hour, you're going to hear from all three of these seasoned professionals about how they approach teamwork and how they get involved with their team to make a marketing campaign truly great. All right, first question. Let's start with Aaron, if you're ready. So given Absolutely. Your position in the team, what do you do to bring creativity to a marketing and advertising challenge?
So in my role, I have almost always been the internal direct marketer. So I have brands that I'm responsible for putting a strategic campaign together, which involves every kind of medium that you can think of as far as reaching your consumer, but also PR, group sales, things like that. So on the live event side, we call it getting butts in seats, if you will. So the challenge with getting butts in seats for brands like the Harlem Globetrotters, which has been around for 94 years, or the Rolling Stones, which have been around for 294 years, seemingly, a Ringling Brothers Circus, which is a year older than baseball, is that sales objectives are never stagnant. So you always have to sell more. And in order to do that, you can't just do what you did last year, even if you set a record. In fact, if you set a record last year, you get to, we have a joke that like, you get to be excited about it literally until the check clears for the company. And then after that, your goals are already up. So it is constantly trying to figure out where the gaps are and how you can in reaching your consumer better. And it gets harder the more successful a particular campaign is, right? Because the gaps get smaller and smaller and harder to identify. So as far as working with a team to do that, whether you're working with a digital agency like Kate and I have worked together on digital, that was an area that I identified that we needed growth. I'm big on knowing what you know, and more than that, knowing what you don't know. And so I'm seeking expertise in areas that you are not the best person to get into the minutia. So for me, really, it's continuing to achieve via working based on the strategy that you have put together, but really utilizing your resources of experts in different areas.
So would it be fair to say that you take a kind of 20,000 foot approach and also a very close up approach to the campaign as a whole versus working on a specific segment, ensuring that it's all cohesive?
Yeah, so I am essentially, so when I work directly for a brand, I am both the coach and the quarterback of the brand. And the way that it was positioned to me when I was a baby marketer, you know, was that you are the CEO of the brand in whatever capacity you're trying to sell it. So, and that's really important, right? Because the buck stops with you. And so you're trying to leverage all of these other, you know, all of these other players. But if something, you need to make sure that you are all driving seamlessly down the field. So you do have to know all of the other parts, not as well. You don't necessarily have to be able to personally perform all of the other roles, but you do have to be aware of what the players are supposed to do when they're not doing it right, and then and be able to ask good questions about how we can improve or what we can tweak in order to excel in each area. And then my job is to know what needs to be tweaked holistically and to effectively use the individual players to do that.
I love it. So back to a Jill of all trades, knowing a little bit about everything and making sure it's all working and, yeah, and calling it out when it's not.
Absolutely.
So how would you define creativity in your role then? Because a lot of times when people say creative, especially in advertising, it's very much so the Gabes of the world, the creative director. But I think every person in advertising is creative in their own way. So how would you define creativity in your specific role?
It's figuring out what those gaps are that I mentioned earlier and how to fill them. And one of the reasons, first of all, everyone thinks they're a marketer, which is so amazing to me that like everyone thinks that they're great at marketing all the time, but no one knows the difference between like marketing and PR. So that's amazing. It is knowing, especially in such a fragmented media environment that we have now, you know, it frustrates a lot of marketers, right? That there's just that it's much, the media market and the way to reach people is much more fragmented than it has ever been. And you have to get more impressions to make anyone make a decision like ever now. And for a lot of people, that's frustrating. For a strategic marketer, that's super exciting, right? Because then number one, job security, yay. But also number two, you know, it's really great to like get your brain thinking about other areas. So for me, creativity is in an ever-changing landscape, both consumer landscape, how they behave, but also media landscape and exposure landscape, how you make, you know, you make those work together and in a symbiotic way that achieves sales goals, right? Because there's very, I really can't think of a product that I've ever worked on that like selling more wasn't better. You know, that's really, you have to be creative to continually sell more.
Very true, very true. Erica, same question. And Gabriel, I promise we'll come to you next. As a senior account manager, especially on these large enterprise accounts that might have more brand guidelines and restrictions. How do you define creativity in your role?
I'd piggyback a little bit off of Aaron, but go a step further. It is about identifying gaps, but I think even before that, a lot of the gaps for me not working internally and working more at an agency is filling in that I have no knowledge of how this marketing is supposed to work together gap. And that is a difficulty. Some people know how social media works and some people do not know how programmatic works. And similar to being the Jill of all trades, I have to know how each of those things speak to one another, but how they cohesively come together to make a plan. So a lot of my time is spent looking at the story and understanding how to tell it creatively, like not just show them a pretty picture, but look at a data slide and be able to say, hey, in the best, most creative way that I can explain these numbers to you that you probably have never seen or don't want to look at right now. Here is what your story is telling you. Here's the insight. Here's where you can really pull your brand in this direction because this data is telling you to do it that way. I can't even explain to you guys. I was talking to Kate before this. I spent hours on a deck right now for Carter's that I am literally looking at spreadsheets on spreadsheets on spreadsheets of formulating, hey, here's what happened in Q3. And this is what that looked like. And then this is how we use those numbers, this data, these trends to then build out your next story as we look at Q4 throughout the holiday season of what we need to market and how we need to tell that story. It's a little bit more of the, how do I connect with somebody and how do I creatively connect with that person and get through all the clutter of, I know we all scroll through TikTok for 5 hours. How do I get through that? How do I reach you? How do I get you to understand this is what you need to do next?
So you're solving for the brand the same problem that the brand is trying to solve for their consumers. What do they need to see? When do they need to see it and how? Yeah. So looking into, you know, a world where there might be too much data, trying to find those nuggets and make them understand the importance of it and how it can impact their campaign. Is that correct?
Exactly. Exactly that. I don't get to do the joys and pleasure as much of working with my creative team and making something amazing in a commercial and digging into it in that way. But I think the way that our team adds value on the agency side of looking at data, pulling out trends and really showing you what the creative, nice, pretty picture stuff is doing for you is the part that I think I add value to in that half.
So would it be twofold? One, using the data to show the creative team here's what's going to work. And then now you do your magic and then showing that same data to your customer, the client, and saying, here's why this is going to work. And then after it runs, here's how it worked and why it did work.
Yep.
Exactly. Perfect. Thank you. All right, Gabriel, your turn, creative director. Let's hear your take on how you work with these other team members and use some of their feedback to impact your creative side.
So, I guess one of the things that I encourage people to do in advertising, especially in creative teams, is try to bring as much diversity as you possibly can. I mean, it never has been more important than today to be able to bring in different ways of thinking, different approaches and different styles to the table, because that's really the foundation of good creative for brands. So to me, that is the most important thing when you're able to build a team that has that component. Now, if you think about, I think there's also like this romantic idea of a creative director being this like a Don Draper kind of guy who's smoking a cigarette and drinking scotch and all of a sudden comes up with this killer tagline and it's just, you know, wonderful and everybody loves it. And I think going back a little bit to what you were saying before about creativity, I think it has to do a lot with just the ability to solve problems for our clients. I think it's just as simple as that. I mean, all of the time we see in our desks, you know, briefs saying that the sales are down or that they need to introduce this new product to the marketplace, or that there's a new store that they need to open and they need to bring as much people as possible to buy their products. So I think when you focus your thinking on those kinds of things and how am I going to solve this problem, there's always the easy solve. I mean, you can always bring in a celebrity hoping that if you have $1 million, you can just put a beautiful face in it and it will do the work for you. But I think audiences nowadays are asking for much more than just that. I think you need to fight in a different arena nowadays, and it's about ideas and concepts, but it's always about finding a right solution for the right clients. So,
great feedback. And that reminds me of when I was in school, when I worked on the National Student Advertising Competition, and it was the first time a diverse group in all different verticals were working together collectively on a campaign. We all wanted to kind of be the creative. We all wanted to come up with that tagline, that idea. And we received so much pushback from our instructors of start with a strategy, start with a why. Why are you trying to do this? Can you discuss a little bit about, was that a hard learning curve for you or for other creatives? Because your education is focused on perfecting this skill set and this talent. And then you go into the real world do you think that they teach you enough about the strategy side of it? Or was it something you kind of had to learn to work with on the fly and change your approach?
I think it's a little bit of both. Of course, when you are starting your career, you just want to have like a big hit, like almost like in the music world. You just want to have like this amazing TV spot that is going to drive everybody crazy. And it's going to have almost like your name on it. And everybody's going to recognize you because of that TV spot. And of course you want to have that, but when you get into the job, you notice that it's not that simple. You need to deliver results and you need to sell products. That's basically what we do here. So in a sense, you have to be able to be creative with a purpose, not just for the sake of being funny or creative. You have to remember, I mean, yes, you could be artistic and in a way, but you have to deliver and you have to bring in sales. So that's why you need to be closer to the strategy people on the business. You need to understand the reality of the client and the business that you're getting into. And you need to understand the problems, the challenges. You need to understand the audience you're talking to. And you need to be an expert in all the mediums that are out there to see when are you going to hit your target and how. So that's the only way to be relevant these days.
So great point. At one of the advertising events, I met the lady who came up with Yo Quiero Taco Bell. And for my generation, everybody knew the Chihuahua. Everybody knew Taco Bell about it. It was a hit. We loved it. And she told me their agency got fired because they didn't sell one additional taco. And that was very eye-opening for me, that no matter how brilliant it can be, if your objective isn't brand awareness,
right,
and your objective is to move sales, it could still be a failure.
Absolutely.
So you made a great point about working closer with strategy and understanding kind of the needs and the different media channels. How do you think it's best for creatives, especially young creatives, to go about that? Is it waiting for their organization or their agency to put them all together in a room? Or should they be doing some of that on their own, volunteering after hours or staying behind, asking to join meetings? Any tips for that?
Well, I guess you have to be able to focus in one area of the business, but that doesn't mean that you should not understand the rest of the disciplines involved in an advertising agency. I mean, I've always been interested, particularly in the strategic part of it, in the planning area, because I like a lot of psychology. I've read a lot of psychology. My mother-in-law happens to be a psychoanalyst, so I try to understand the insights and the reasons why people do certain things and have certain behaviors. So when you have that interest, I mean, you find you have more weapons, if you will, more tools to approach a problem and go directly to those targets, to that person that you're trying to bring a message to. So it's a matter of interest, but at the same time, you cannot forget, I mean, if you're a creative and that's your thing, you need to study a lot. I mean, I guess one of the things that I used to hear a lot when I was in college was like this notion of, I don't want to be a doctor because those guys are always studying and they have to be updating themselves all the time. Well, guess what? I'm in advertising, and 20 years after, I'm still learning and I'm still going to events like this and I'm still reading almost every day and trying to learn new things about creativity and advertising. So you have to be updated and you have to be very well educated in your craft and learn and inform your thinking with other disciplines as well.
Very great point. Great way to answer an interview question when asked how you stay up to date is talking about your involvement in the American Advertising Federation, whether it's at the Ad 2 level or AAF level. So attending events like this is a great way to respond because that's an expectation in our industry. It's ever evolving and it's not going to stop. So really good point. Psychoanalyst mother-in-law, I would love to talk to you about that offline, but that's very interesting.
Yeah.
All right, next question for our
panelist. I'm sure it's more interesting for her than for me, but
yeah. I would love her take on advertising. No, I'm just kidding. Okay, so let's go back to Aaron. Aaron, I know you spoke about being the quarterback and kind of the buck stops here. So what is your role as in the campaign building process? And what do you usually consider your specific deliverables? What is your baby? What do you take ownership in that process?
So it really depends on the structure of the organization and the size of the organization. So for example, if you work for a Coca-Cola, you don't specifically work. I mean, you might be paid by Coca-Cola, but say you also work, you actually really work for Minute Maid and specifically like their juice. Specific juice, orange juice, let's go orange. So, but then under that, so you're responsible for you determine generally whether it is sales growth, brand awareness, and the degree to which it is. And then if you're at a large company, you may have other people who kind of report into you. So you set the strategy, the overall strategy, and then you manage the people in different silos. And you're ultimately responsible for everything, but you're not the one working with Kate to place the digital. And some companies, larger companies, have all of these, have creatives and have kind of everyone in the silos in-house. Smaller companies don't. And so, they do things like hiring out agencies, in digital or PR and creative and, brand and stuff like that. So it really does depend on the size of the agency, on the size of the company. Where I am and the companies that I have been at, I've been at different size companies and I have done everything from literally placing the advertising myself, the spots and dots, like working with the media reps, negotiating literally how many GRPs we're gonna get, for a particular amount of money and going back and forth on all of that. I've worked for companies that have done that. I've worked for companies where I set the strategy, kind of high level strategy, and then, for each silo. And I've had other people work specifically on, how does digital fit into the mix? Specifically, what is the exposure we're going to get via digital? What's the exposure we're going to get via TV? What's the exposure we're going to get via PR? How do we do, other sales, consignment sales or group sales or whatever? So it really depends on the structure of the company. My personal preference, I don't love being in the weeds. I'm like over, like, that's where you're going to start though, y'all. You are absolutely going to be the ones following up with the TV stations, making sure that the spot ran where it was supposed to run on the particular day. And you're going to be calling them and telling them it ran and, you know, it was supposed to be a donut, but it wasn't a donut and whatnot. So you will start there and it just is what it is. But that's also not to say that you'll never have to do it again. In a lot of companies, it's all hands on deck. If you have a big campaign breaking and it's really, you know, the goals are really clear and you have to be, you know, extremely successful at it, then everybody's all hands on deck. And it's important that you know, you know, kind of how to go from the trenches up. I would love to say that I used my trench skills only in the trenches. That is not true at all. But I do look forward in, I don't know what kind of utopia where I never have to place an ad personally again. That would be amazing. But that's just not reality.
I laugh because one of my first jobs in advertising was media planning and buying. And I remember the panic when a value ad spot didn't run. I was like, this is not life and death. This is really a free ad that we didn't even ask for, that we were given that didn't run, and now we're panicking.
Call them at 11 p.m. and wonder why it ran in the wrong place with a competitor against the competitor spot. That cannot happen, and you want 75 make goods.
Exactly. Perfect. Well, thank you. Same question to you, Erica. What's kind of your baby in the campaign building process? What part do you have ownership of? And what part would you like to have ownership of that maybe you don't get to?
Currently, current day, not as high level as Erin is. I am still in the trenches. I am still on everyone's behind to be the most PG rated about what you did, when you did it, and why it didn't happen when I told you it should have happened. My biggest role right now is honestly the creation of the deck. I think if we're talking about in relevant terms of what you guys are gonna do, my job has always been, here's all the pieces, put it together and make it into a story. So here's this person's lane, this person's lane, this person's lane. And I then take that, ingest it, and go, here's this, and it's great, and we're gonna tell this story, and this is how everybody's gonna work together. I prefer it that way. I am that person that, I like to call myself, this is gonna sound so weird, but I wrote an article about account management, and I call account managers curious octopuses, and there's a reason for this. We ask a lot of questions because I do not fully understand your job. I know enough, but I don't know all of it. And I have to wear 8 different hats and do 9 different things all at once. So I have these tentacles that are going and pulling and grabbing, but I'm taking everything and trying to make it into this nice, pretty, perfect picture. Here it is for the client wrapped up. I agree with Erin in the sense of if I never had to check in on somebody or schedule a meeting again for the rest of my life, I would 100% be down for that. reality of it, I'm always going to have to schedule a call. I'm always going to be the one pulling in the ropes and bringing everyone in back together. But ideally, I love presenting in front of clients. That was always my thing. Even when I did, for our campaigns class at UT Arlington, I didn't do NSAC because we didn't have an NSAC team, but our finals course, like the last class that you take for advertising, was your campaign. And we had a real client. It was Texas Credit Union, who worked down the street office in Arlington. And so we went over there and we did a full campaign for them, pitched to the client, the whole 9 yards. And my job was putting together that presentation. It wasn't making any of the design part of it because that's not my skill set, but it was building the story and pulling the pieces together and looking at the research behind it. So that's really what I would consider my baby during the entire process.
All right, tough follow-up question. Have you ever had to present something that you didn't necessarily believe in or like, but your team members maybe felt very strongly about? Absolutely. Fake it till you make it, or what do you do?
Absolutely. It's a tough pill to swallow. I'll tell you that. First thing is get unmad. Whatever way that is, you have to figure out how to calm yourself down. I think the number one thing that you have to constantly do is find the nice way to ask somebody, are you stupid? without saying, are you stupid? Like that, Because to you, it's like, that is the dumbest thing I've ever heard. But to them, it made sense. So it's literally a lot of the times me going, for whatever reason, this makes sense to everybody in the room but me. Let me ask questions. And I'm not just asking questions so that I can make sure I know that you're crazy and you don't know what you're talking about. But I'm also asking questions for the fact of, if I have to speak to it, at least I know all the little details that I need to know. And I'm understanding it from people who believe in it more than I do, so that when I'm presenting, it doesn't come across as though, like, I'm like, I mean, yeah, like, this is the creative and this is what they did, but it comes across as, we did it for this reason, not my reasoning, someone else's, but still pulling it in. It is a fake it till you make it situation. But again, you have to, you really have to pull yourself out of your own head and sit there and say, okay, everybody else likes it for a reason. How do I pull these pieces together and understand where their brains were at when this was getting ideated, so that when I present it back, it's not BS fluff coming out of my mouth?
I'm a big advocate for fail fast and learn from it. And in similar situations, we've had some campaigns where I worked for a spine company, and there was so much controversy around one social media post. And it was just, when's the last time you were able to walk your dog? And we found some insights that people miss the minor things in life that you don't even think twice about, like leaving our houses and taking that for granted during a pandemic. But yeah, we did a post. It was wonderful. And then it sparked so much creativity to where a whole campaign launched about just getting back to normal. And it was, we had a lot of pushback on it, and then it ended up being a beautiful thing. And I think one of the hardest things in advertising is remembering that just because you do something or don't do something doesn't mean the customer is going to. Everyone is different.
Yep. Getting all those experiences pulled in, asking everyone's opinion at the table, I think is something that's valuable, especially in an account management role, because my experience is going to be different than Gabe's experience, is different than Aaron's experience. And understanding where they're coming from helps me go back to the consumer and say, well, if Gabe was going to buy this, he probably wouldn't do it because it's pink and he hates pink and I love pink. And now we're just getting something that's pink that I think everyone's going to want to buy, but clearly it's not going to happen. So getting that understanding and being able to sit back and say, all right, Gabe wants it blue, I want it pink. For the client's best interest, we're going to do blue. I might not agree, but this is how we need to present it, because this is going to work for the vast majority of your clientele versus a
perfect section. Or A/B test it and let's see who wins. But I think you and Gabe both spoke to, the necessity of having a diverse team and diverse perspectives, whether it's different backgrounds, different career experiences. So I think advertising has been a little bit ahead of the times in that, and I'm very proud of our industry for that, and I'm excited to see how much further we push that to make sure everyone has a voice. Gabe, up to you. I think a lot of people think they know what your baby is in the campaign building process, but do you want to clarify as creative director, and maybe speak to, growing in your career when you started off as a graphic designer or different roles, what was your part of the process and how has that evolved over the years?
Copywriter, let me correct you right there. I have a copywriter background. So I respect our directors, especially because I'm not one, but I started as a copywriter. Well, I guess right now as a creative director, my role should be a little more, on the strategic side of things. I mean, like thinking big picture and nowadays clients expect the creative directors to show up to the meetings, being the ones presenting the ideas and making the clients laugh, and trying to be funny and just sell the ideas. And I do some of that, but that's just not my personality. I'm not the one sitting at my desk just waiting for creatives to bring me ideas and fresh thinking. I like to be in the creative process. The one thing that I love about my job is just sitting in front of a computer, having nothing, that like the white paper, and just starting from scratch having a goal to achieve and a brief and a communication goal to communicate. So I love the whole process and sitting down. I mean, for me, brainstorming, it's one of the most beautiful things that I can that I have in my job, and sitting down with other creatives and just coming up with stuff, you know, sometimes it's funny, sometimes nothing pops up in 2 hours and you're just trapped in a room trying to come up with something. But I just love that process. So to answer your question, I mean, I guess since I am the one with the most, I mean, the senior member in the team who knows the client, who knows the brands, I should be the one providing direction and being able to say this idea works, this one doesn't. This one, it's risky, but let's put it together. Let's put it in front of the client. I should be the one deciding that. But since I'm because I enjoy the process of coming up with ideas, I sit down with the creatives, and sometimes I'm the one who came up with the idea and took it all the way from an idea to an execution and to a presentation. Or sometimes I'm just the one, you know, saying, "Oh yeah, that was beautiful. Keep working on that, and let's put it in the deck." I play pretty much a little bit of everything. And one thing that I think Erica touched a little bit earlier is one thing that has made a big difference in the way we operate with our clients is that it's not just one idea. I encourage creative teams to show up to a client's presentation with at least 2 or hopefully 3 or more ideas, so the client has a range of thinking. So, I mean, one problem has always, you know, different angles to be approached, and there's always multiple ways to solve a problem. So if you just come with one, I mean, the client is only going to say yes or no. I mean, it's a big risk. But if a client sees 2 or 3 or 4 different proposals, then it's okay. Now I'm trying to understand what you're bringing me. I mean, this one is a little more political, or this one is a little more creative, and this one is a hard selling idea, and they appreciate that, and that's something that you need to train yourself to do it, because you never know what's in the mind of a client, and let alone you never know what's in the mind of your consumers. So you need to have different approaches to cover your bases.
Great point. So not just falling in love with one idea, your first good idea, keep pushing yourself and seeing what really resonates with others being the client who knows their customers in a different way than you and your research may know them.
Correct.
Great feedback. So we want to thank everyone who has submitted some questions. At this time, I want to answer a few of these. First, let's answer from an account manager position. What jobs did you start out with to get there? Erica and Aaron, do you want to give a high-level overview of kind of how you became account managers, or how you worked off that way? Aaron, I know your title is slightly different, but assuming you went that route, if not, please correct.
Go ahead, Erica. You're more like exactly in that role, and then I can take you back off of that.
But based off my title, I started as a digital account coordinator. That's typically what they're labeled as, or an account coordinator, or a junior account strategist or coordinator. It's typically what that job title is gonna, like if you were doing a search on LinkedIn, that's what it would start out as. I personally started out specifically in digital. I knew I wanted to stay online and within technology. But if you're gonna go into more of a agency setting, you're probably gonna find more coordinator roles. That's just like an account coordinator. Which will be in a step below an account manager. And then from there, it pretty much levels up the same way across most companies, which is you're a coordinator, you're an account manager, you're a senior account manager, and then you go to an account director role. So it's just bop, 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 all the way back up.
So another side of that is that, And I don't know that you, I think this is where like internships are a great opportunity, not to, I mean, I know internship is such a buzzword. Everybody do as many internships as you can, whatever. But the flip side to the account manager path. So I could never be an account manager. I'm always meant to be the client. I am never meant to service a client. That is, see Kate's laughing because she knows that is like not my jam. I currently do now kind of on the side, do some client work and, don't love it. So if you are an internal marketer, right, which means you're responsible for the brand, the trajectory is kind of the same, right? Like you start out generally in one of the silos. So you'll start out, you know, as like a digital assistant or a broadcast assistant or whatever. And then you work your way up to taking on more and more and more of the strategies. So the trajectory is the same. What I would say is just because you don't feel like you're a great fit for like running the brand as the direct marketer on the brand side, that doesn't mean you won't be a good account manager, right? But I do think that most people are either, if they're really great at one, they're not great at the other. They can do the other, but it's just like, not what they're amazing at. I mean, I've never really met somebody who like is like, I love doing it equally, both being on the client side and the agency side. I just don't know people like that. So I think that there is, I don't think that that's something that you can know before you do it, right? Because if I went into it, I love talking, I love, you know, brainstorming ideas. I love all of that. So you would think, and I love selling in people into things and I love presenting. You would think that I'd be like the best account manager ever. But as Kate's face indicated, the minute that I said it, I am not. So I think you have to try it and really get into it and take the opportunity to try both paths and see which more gels for you.
I agree with Erin. I did an internal communications intern at Sabre. Which they do technology. So again, still staying in my same space that I knew I was gonna like, but they do technology specifically for airlines, which my mom was a flight attendant, I traveled, I'm a military kid, like all the things that really matched up with my life that I was like, oh my God, I'm gonna love this. And I was writing internal blog articles and I absolutely hated it. And I have dual majors in like public relations and advertising. So writing was a strong suit for me. But internal communications is completely different than what I would do at an agency, writing my own like agency briefs and articles, like completely different style. And I absolutely hated it. I did not enjoy it. And I ended up going agency side and that's what I fell in love with. So I completely agree. Test it, internships are the best way. But honestly, I stayed at my first position as that digital marketing coordinator for 6 months and I didn't like it and I found a new job and I kept going from there and I kept building till I found the niche that I liked. So I agree, like try the things.
Yeah, highly recommend doing internships. They also have day of like job shadowing. While you're a student, you have so many open doors. Ask people, just message them on LinkedIn, meet people in network and ask them questions. They'll be open and vulnerable with you. As soon as you lose that student title, you kind of lose some of that ability and that access. So great recommendations from both of you. Gabe, from your perspective, how often or how closely does the account manager work with you as a creative director?
All the time. I mean, it's a constant communication. And it has to be that way because, I mean, this person has the contact with the client and the day-to-day relationship. And so that informs your way of thinking creatively. And so one thing that is very important in any advertising agency is the idea that you're working in a team and everybody gets to do their part. And so yes, you can spend some time brainstorming and doing your creative work, but you have to be in constant communication, understanding what the client needs are all the time. So and I think that's crucial. So there's always this thing, and every agency that I work for, there's always this thing that there's like a little battle between creatives and account services. I just hate that. When I see some of that, it's just I have to stop it, because I mean, we have to remember that we're a team. We may see things differently, and I understand perfectly the role of the of account people need it. I see them as the voice of the client inside of the agency and the voice of the agency inside of the client's mind. So their role is very complicated. So you need to understand that they're under a lot of pressure. So if you don't understand that, and you don't put in yourself in their shoes, I mean, it's gonna fail for everyone. So you try to be understanding of that and try to have a good relationship with that department. Because if a client sees that there's a good relationship, there's a good team partnering with them, they appreciate and just the work flows much better.
Erica, anything to add from your perspective?
No, we do work extremely closely. It's constant communication. It's nonstop. I can't explain how many messages we send back and forth on Slack of just like, hey, just to confirm, hey, I just want to make sure. And we're both tagging along and going back and forth. And I agree. I do think I've had friends that have agencies or where they work, they do have a little bit of that tug and pull between creative and account management. I agree with you, Gabe. I am 100% against it. I think the quickest way around it is to ask where that person's coming from. I'm a very big proponent of, if you don't know and you don't get it, ask. Just ask. Like, a creative's not gonna get mad at you if you're like, I don't understand this, it makes no sense to me. Because if it doesn't make sense to you, typically a creative will go, all right, if it doesn't make sense to her, it's probably not gonna make that much sense to the client. So let me figure out what she's confused about so that I can maybe tweak one element of my design and maybe not restart the whole thing. Maybe it's just one thing that she doesn't get. And now we're collaborating and we don't even realize that we're collaborating because he's able to get his expression out. I'm not cutting him off being like, this is horrible, this is ugly, I hate it. Like, we're working cohesively together to make that relationship stronger. That I think that's valuable, it's important.
Perfect, thank you. And guys, we really appreciate a lot of these questions, but I wanna remind you that Saturday's panel will be covering how to get your start. So we're gonna try to focus more on today's panel focus, which is building a campaign and kind of behind the scenes look. So I'm going to skip ahead to this question on Gabriel. How do you coach your team out of roadblocks and maybe even yourself out of roadblocks when you're kind of having that, that creativity just isn't flowing and you have writer's block and you don't know how to break through to the challenge ahead.
One of my first bosses was this Australian guy in Leo Burnett, Mexico City. In Leo Burnett, they have this program, this exchange program where they would send creative directors to other countries within the network to work for a few months and try to learn about the culture and try to teach the way of thinking within the Overnet network. So one of the things, he noticed when he came to the Mexico City office, we were in a building that because of the way that street was, it was an eighth floor, and yet on the lobby, you would have to go down because it was in the middle of a hill. So it was a very weird place. And he could not believe how people could brainstorm inside of an office. Because in the Sydney office, they were next to the beach and they would brainstorm surfing 2 to 3 days a week. So in his mind, it was like, how can you guys be brainstorming here, like trapped in an office? So after that, he would take us to do, there's this place near Mexico City where it's like a little river where you go fishing. We would go fishing to do brainstorming sessions just to get out of the office space and just to see the world and try to come up with something different. And so I embraced that since the very beginning. I was like, yeah, that's beautiful. I love that. So I don't I don't understand why people are doing brainstormings in a little office. So to me, it's like go for a walk, go for a drive, go get out of here, go for a coffee. And it's just, you'll see life differently after you just go for a walk. And then you can clean up your head and it's just completely different thinking. So yeah, to me, it's doing different things, trying not to stay in the same place, approach this thing, approach this problem for like maybe like an hour, then forget about it completely, go to the movies or whatever you have to do, and then come back to it with a different way of thinking. And that helps a lot.
I love that. I always say, as soon as I stop thinking about this, I'm going to think about it. Because yeah, that's how my brain works. When I try to change it, aha, it'll pop out and it'll be there for me. And I think American culture, we don't tend to utilize all of our paid time off and our vacation days. And that's a great opportunity to recharge, find inspiration, and come back with a whole new outlook of things. And there's some great agencies out there doing, you know, one day inspirational, you know, days off. Hey, go out, inspire yourself, inspire others, and come back and let us know what you learned. So I love that approach. Thank you for sharing that. Okay, so I know you all talked about this a little bit. How much do you personally understand what other team members do when you collaborate with them? And how does learning more about other people's jobs help you with that collaboration process?
So on my side of things, it's a balance, right? Because part of being the overall strategist is you're not supposed to be so in the weeds. Like, that's not where your expertise is. So it's knowing enough to ask good questions, and questions that can either raise red flags like we're not on the right track, or questions that are related to how one specific strategy with one mechanism plays into another strategy. Like, you do need to know how to make those connections. But like, I don't know, and this might sound ridiculous to you, but it is absolutely something that I have no interest in correcting. I have no idea how Facebook ad copy gets into Facebook. I don't care to know. It is not my job. It is not good use of my time. I'd rather do something else. So it's stuff, I mean, yeah, if I had an infinite amount of brain space, then sure. And an infinite amount of time, then sure. But, you know, it's knowing what balls you need to personally be juggling and how those balls interact with each other in order to juggle them. But you don't actually personally have to juggle all the tiny balls. So I don't think that it's, you know, and I think that it's something that you figure out also relative to your organization, right? Because if you do have a lean organization and you're inherently responsible for more, then you have to get into the minutia and you have to know it, just because that's how you have to function. But some organizations, you have the luxury of having really amazing experts in a field, and it's just not worth your time to do their job too.
Great point. You can't do it all. You shouldn't do it all. You have a team, and that's why you should work together and collaborate. Erica or Gabe, do you have anything to add to that?
I mean, I second what Aaron said. It really depends on what you're doing. And honestly, who knows what about the most, I guess, is the best way to phrase it. If I have somebody that I know is a really great specialist, I tend to not learn their job because I don't have a gap to fill. If I know I have somebody who maybe is a little bit newer, starting out maybe in social media, whatever, I know that, okay, I might have to halfway juggle this ball with this person, especially when it comes to client meetings, when I know I have to be face-to-face, I probably can't rely on this person to answer every single question. But again, as that person grows, then I lessen my load and I put more on that person. But a lot of the times my job, I mean, if I'm in a client meeting and it's just me and I don't have any specialists on the call, I need to know enough to hold my own and to not make the client feel weird when I have to say, let me get back to you. But if you say that too many times, people start to look at you like you don't know anything.
Yeah.
So there is a portion of it that like I have a responsibility to understand how SEO works or how paid social works or how programmatic buys work. But do I need to know, as Aaron said, how to put Facebook copy in Facebook? Absolutely not. Do I know that? Yes, I do, for whatever random reason.
Can you teach me?
Yeah. Yes. Do you want to know how to run display ads too? I know how to work.
No,
that. Weird.
But you guys are so right. You put the right people in the right job and then get out of their way. Let them do their job. Be there as a support as they need you to build that confidence or to learn a little bit about your role and other roles in the organization. But you hired people for a reason and you have to build that trust.
Yep.
Gabe, anything you would like to add?
Well, I guess, yeah, I agree with what has been said. I guess one of the things that I have is that even though as I'm a creative director, again, one of the most senior members of the team, you're always learning something new from the other members. So I guess when Erica says, yeah, when someone is the expert in certain areas, and I mean, you want to try to learn a little bit from them. I mean, because everything helps. I mean, knowledge is not, it's something that it's not going to hurt. So if there's someone that can teach you something, I just get closer to that person.
Yeah. I love it. And then one last question to wrap this up. I know this year has been one of tremendous change and a challenge for a lot of individuals, whether from a well-being health standpoint or just, you know, stress levels, but also for the brands and the customers they serve. What do you think how has that affected your work with your team and your campaigns this year? And if anybody can answer without utilizing the term unprecedented times, I might send you a bonus gift card or something in the mail.
Oh, I'm on this. So in live events, I have done other marketing aspects besides live events, but in live events, 98% of people do not have their jobs because there are not live events right now. So over 400,000 marketers also do not have their jobs. And that's kind of crazy if you think about it. So the marketers that do have their jobs, they're fighting harder than ever to keep their jobs, but also they're really having to, and so I just graduated from grad school and I was not in a full-time gig. I left the Globetrotter so I could do grad school. But I do have clients that that I take on, you know, kind of at an ad hoc basis. And the challenge is, you have to consider all of the different facets of where a consumer is now, where the media prices are different now, how people consume media is different now. And I don't mean media just like broadcast. I mean, anything, any input is different now. What people are willing to do with their time is different now. Where people's relationship to money is different now. And it's not really relative to whether they currently have money, it's whether they think they're going to have money. If they think they're going to have a job, everyone is terrified right now, whether they should be as far as people, I don't mean terrified, I mean unsettled. Everyone as far as purchasing decisions are unsettled right now. Nobody is really eager to part with their money. And whether that is a reality that it's based on, or whether it's just people being people, and you can ask your psychologist mother-in-law about it. You know, you have to deal with where your consumers are, not with where they should be. And then quickly tying back to something that was mentioned earlier, something I think it is so important to be cognizant of, no matter where you are on the team, is that you most likely are not the primary consumer. It is very, very unlikely that the product that you will be working for is one that the bulk of sales comes from you. So it doesn't matter if you like blue or pink. Like, that's not the thing. It's what does the data say about the consumer, or, and what's the reaction? The other thing is, consumers do not care as much as you do. They really do not. If you're lucky, most consumers, if you can get a consumer to care about you at all, you have done your job. But consumers will not consider you more than once or twice or three times, depending on like what the product is and, you know, the degree to which they need it and things like that. But like, consumers are not sitting there looking at that ad all day. They are not worrying about the period and the font. And yes, it's important. It all works together to communicate an idea. But like, if you think the consumer really cares, they're just going to move on to something else. They really are. They've got a lot going on. So that's even more so during COVID, right? Consumers have so much more going on in their brains than, you know, what kind of diapers they're going to buy or whether they're going to buy Minute Maid orange juice versus whatever other orange juice. So you really have to adjust your strategy to where the consumers are in the moment. And we are in a really wacky moment. And there's not a lot of data, right? So you have to use your gut. You have to use other people that are educated in the area. You have to do your intel as far as other brands that you've seen navigate where we are right now successfully. It's a lot more work to sell things than it used to be. But if you're interested in the strategy, and I don't mean just marketing strategy, I mean, if you're interested in the strategy of the creative, if you're interested in the strategy of a campaign, it's a really exciting time. Because we've never been pressed like this before. Yeah. Is my soapbox on COVID?
No, so true. It's definitely strange times. Erica, Gabe, anything to add on how it's impacted your approach?
You go first, Gabe.
Well, I guess to me, I feel I'm in a very lucky place because our largest client is having a record in sales this year. I mean, Sonic Drive-In, their business model was almost built for this thing. Okay. So, and now they have this app where you have like minimal contact, physical contact with the person providing your food. I mean, it's just, you just order and there's, I mean, and you just go in and then you pick it up and you can stay in your car or you can leave. And when you have your largest client having crazy record-breaking sales, I mean, that sets the tone for the agency and we're in a very lucky situation. So, and it's not just them, there's a couple other clients that are going through a good year. So it could be crazy, it could be terrible for others. It's good for certain clients that are making huge profits with this situation. And it's one of those things. And I agree, Erin. I mean, it's marketing is probably the first area where you have this little crisis and layoffs are seen in marketing immediately. So there's a lot of super talented people looking for a job these days. And it breaks my heart. But at the same time, this is one of those situations where, you know, it could change from one day to the next. I mean, and people start getting confidence again and hiring and the economy gets back on track. But we're in a very, strange moment. I mean, I've never seen anything like this before. I'm not going to use the word unprecedented. Oh, I used it. Sorry. But again,
you're removed from the from the drawing. I'm sorry.
I did. Sorry.
I would say the only thing that I have to add to that, tying in Erin and Gabe's mindset too, is I can't tell you how sick and tired of commercials that I saw when this first all started that were sad music. We're here for you. And I was like, are you Ford? Are you gonna bring a new truck to my front door? How with me are you? Like this, but like it was so crazy to me to watch people jump on that trend, and it was brand after brand, and I was like, oh my gosh, like what is happening? Why is everybody doing this? And now that we've been through this for 6, 7, 8 months now, I'm now seeing people being like, oh okay, maybe this wasn't the right direction. I'm like, Maybe people didn't want to buy new trucks when thousands of people were losing their jobs and things were shutting down. Maybe we should have thought about a different approach. And I think the thing that I've said around my office to too many clients is, what are your shopper preferences? What shopper preferences do you offer? And everyone's like, what do you mean? I'm like, are you offering curbside, contactless? What's your e-commerce site look like? What do all these things that people are now having to use as a shopping option, what are you doing about that? Because if you don't have an e-commerce site right now, like you're already 20,000 steps behind the curve. If you don't offer at least buy online and pick up in store where I can purchase it, walk in, grab my bag and walk away, you're behind the curve. It's literally me asking those same questions over and over. And these are models that realistically, they probably won't go away. I think people obviously agree. Use curbside and BOPIS, which is buy online, pick up in store, for decades, because now it's just a new convenience. I think we're already getting to that point with things like Uber Eats and things like that, where I was already not having to do a lot of the legwork anyway. But that's really, at least in the account management world, how I've seen that change. And the data that I'm now ingesting is no longer just, hey, let's look at how local performance is doing, meaning people coming into stores. It's literally, okay, within local, how many people are coming to our buy online site? Like, how many people are checking out this way? What are they doing when they come in the store? Are people really searching for information about how often you clean your stores? And the answer is yes. People are still asking, how frequently is it sanitized? Do your workers wear gloves? Is everyone masked? These are things that are constantly top of mind, and I've noticed has consistently been at the top of the board, at least throughout this time frame. And I think it's not going to change. And I think it's just our way of adapting through the situation as we move forward. As more things open, as jobs open, e-commerce isn't going to end. Curbside's not going to end. It's just built into the business models now.
Yep. And, you know, as a company, I work for a company that sells disinfection technology. And I'll tell everybody, we don't sell that. We sell peace of mind. And that is my whole role right now. And from a little bit of an advertising standpoint, those pesky QR codes are back, and I don't think they're going anywhere. Everyone's getting more and more used to them. And as much as some of our design team hates it, we're like, everyone's used to it now. It's the norm. But I just want to wrap this up, guys. We're a little over time. I want to thank each and every one of you for sharing your time and your expert. Yes, QR codes are back. I want to thank everybody for sharing their time with us and their expertise. I know, you know, right now it's challenging times for all. It can be difficult to be motivated and present. I graduated during a, you know, crisis. And if you're graduating this year, keep your head up. There's a lot of people looking for jobs, but you guys are out here doing what you need to be doing. And, your approach and your continued education and, your mindset will help you land that dream job. And lean on us. We're here to help you. Thank you all again for joining us. Thank you, Gabe. Thank you, Aaron. Thank you, Erica. Big thank you to Rose, Valentina, and Kate, for putting all of this together in AAF Houston.